And we have been talking about what are the various kinds of air pollutants, then what are the sources of air pollution, what are the ill effects of air pollution. These are the things we have talked about. Now let's start with the good part, which means how can we control air pollution. So we all know about the problems and all. So how can we solve it? What are the things that are in our hands? We will talk about it. So the thing is, I have, I think, taught one or two slides of this, but I will still start from the first slide. So the pollutants are required to be removed if possible. If possible, you can destroy them or you can transform them in a control device. Transform into something which is not a pollutant. Okay. So depending on the kind of pollutant you have to decide which option you have to choose. Okay. So if it is a gaseous pollutant, then we go for these kind of things: absorption, adsorption, condensation, and combustion. So these are various kinds of approaches by which we can control the pollution. Okay. And these are names of some control devices. One device is called gravitational settling chamber. Then we have cyclone separator, which is another kind of control device. Then we have fabric filters, electrostatic precipitators. So when do we use this kind of approaches? When it is particulate pollutants. So if you remember from the last class, we had known about particulate pollutants and gaseous pollutants. These were the two types of pollutants we had. Okay. So gaseous pollutants are very small and you cannot actually use any kind of physical properties related to solids. Well, these are not solids actually. But if it is not gaseous, if it is some kind of liquid or solid, then we go for this kind of approaches, particulate. Okay. So let's look into this. Gravitational settling chamber, that's the first one. So how do we use it? Let's look at it. So this is a device. Just imagine it's a part of the whole device, and the gas comes in this way, it goes out in this way. So here we make the gas travel through a large distance, and when it travels, all the particles which can be settled, which are actually particulate matters. It is used to remove large excessive particles. If the size of the particles are more than 50 micron, then when it passes through this chamber, it will slowly start settling down. It will come to the bottom, so it can be collected. Okay. And then when the gas comes out, at least the particulate matters are not present when it comes out. So instead of making it eject through this way, along with the particulate matter, this kind of devices can be used so that we can at least get rid of the particulate matter. Okay. So how does it work? So this is just a simple diagram. A bit more complicated diagram is this. So the gas enters, and then there are so many layers. Okay. The gas stream with its entrained particles enter at one end and leaves on the other end, that you can understand. The air velocity is reduced for allowing the particulates to settle. So it is slowed down. Okay. So the when the gas will go very slowly, the particles will have more time to settle. Okay. So all these layers are created so that gas cannot pass easily. And finally, the outlet is given at the top, so the particulate matter reduces. Okay. So this is gravitational settling. Now let's talk about cyclonic separator. Cyclone separator. So this is how the chamber looks like. What are they trying to do is, when the gas enters this chamber, it is made to circulate, or in other words, flow in a circular pattern. So if you remember about your centrifugal force in physics, then you can understand when the gas flows in a circular pattern, then because of the centrifugal force, the particles get attached to the wall of the body, okay, wall of this body or of this chamber, and then it slowly comes down. Okay, so this is another way of separating. So here a bit of extra force is utilized. So you can very well imagine that compared to this scenario, in this scenario the efficiency will be more, obviously, because you are actually using some energy to make the gas flow in a circular pattern. Okay. So the important things are written over here. There is a small YouTube video link also given. You can watch it just to understand how it works. So in case if you have forgotten what centrifugal force is, I'll just, for those who have forgotten, just a reminder, when you are traveling on a car maybe, and there is a curve ahead of the road, and so when the car negotiates that turn on the road, you will feel like a force is acting in the lateral direction, and it is trying to push you away along the through the window. Okay, you will feel a force which is pulling you towards the window of the car. So that is centrifugal force. So imagine the gas to be this car and yourself as a particle. So when the gas travels in a circular pattern, the particle will start to move laterally. So it will try to move laterally and it will try to attach onto the wall of this chamber. Okay. So this is the cycle of separators. Next we have fabric filters. So fabric filter is basically when the particles are even smaller. Cannot use even circular separator also, cycling separator also. You will use this kind of filter. So for those who use bikes, you know that there is an air filter inside. Okay? The air filter tries to trap the particulate matter so that the air which goes inside the engine is clean. Okay, so it's that kind of filter. Okay, so the gas enters, it passes through the filter, only the gas can pass, whereas the particles actually gets trapped into these filters. Okay, so this is the inlet, then it passes through all these filters and finally it comes out. This is a hopper. Hopper means this filter, when it is shaken, all the particles that are attached on this filter will come down and finally it will be collected. Okay, so this is another way. So what kind of material is used, if you want to know that? So this is a 0.5 microfarad. Okay, air enters through this direction and it has a lot of particles, and finally there is another kind of membrane attached to it. It's 20 to 30 micron fabric. So if you compare, then this is more finer, this is a bit coarser, but both of them are attached so that if any particle is able to pass through this first layer, it will get trapped onto the second. Okay, then finally you get the clean air. Now, when filters are also unable to trap the particles, we need even sophisticated particles, filters, and that is called electrostatic precipitators. Okay, an example could be thermal power plant. So when in thermal power plant, when coals are burnt, okay, so the particle which comes out is so fine that none of these techniques that I have shown you before, gravitational settling chamber, cyclonic separator, or fabric filter, none of this will work. So finally we need to go with electrostatic precipitators. So how does that work? So if you remember electrostatic induction, can you just give me a thumbs up how many of you remember electrostatic induction? You have studied in class 11 electrostatic induction. Do you remember anything about it? Okay, anyone else? Electrostatic induction. So basically, we charge the objects by rubbing them with each other, right? We charge them, one of them become positively charged and the other become negatively charged. So here, what is done is that the particles which are very difficult to trap are charged, let's say positively, whereas the chamber is charged negatively, okay? So you see, the gas passes in this direction, and this whole chamber is charged opposite to that of the particulates present in the gas. Okay, so what will happen now when gravitational force has failed, electrostatic force will come into play. If you remember a bit about all the forces that you have studied in your higher secondary classes, you remember that electrostatic force of attraction is much, much stronger than gravitational force of attraction. So that is why when you charge them, what happens is that these particles will get immediately attracted onto the walls of the chamber, and finally the clean gas will be able to pass. So it's that simple. I'll repeat the whole process once again. The particulate matter will get charged, the whole chamber will remain charged as well, and they will be oppositely charged. So when they're oppositely charged, all the particles will get attracted and they will attach with the chamber, wall of the chamber, and the gas will easily pass through. You don't have to draw these diagrams. These are for your understanding purposes. Which diagram you might need to draw is this kind of diagram. Okay? You might be asked to draw this diagram. You will not be asked to draw this diagram. You have to draw this kind of diagram. So the simple diagrams that you can see here, you might be asked to draw in your exams. If it is a quiz exam, obviously these kind of questions won't come, right? So this is how it will work. This is your electrostatic precipitator. Okay, all the important things are given over here. The details you can read by yourself. So the thing is, the whole fundamental principle behind this electrostatic precipitator is that since electrostatic force of attraction is much, much stronger than gravitational force of attraction, we try to charge the particles. And when they are charged, it is very easy to trap them within the chamber so that the gas can easily clean. Okay. So electrostatic precipitator. So anyone, do you want to ask me anything about this ESP? Some of you might have any confusion. Anything? Okay then. So there is a small YouTube video also for you. You can use this link to watch the videos. Now see, we have been talking about particulate pollutants, how to control them, how to clean them, etc. Right? Now we will talk about how to clean air which has gaseous pollutants. How do we do that? Okay. Control of gaseous pollutants. Absorption, adsorption, condensation, and combustion. So what is absorption? So it is the removal of one or more selected components of a gas mixed by absorption is probably the most important operation in the control of gaseous pollutant emission. So try to focus on this diagram here. You have a liquid film, okay, small thin liquid film. This is the liquid and this is the gas. So absorption is the process by which a gaseous pollutant is dissolved in a liquid. So when the gas passes through this liquid, it gets dissolved in the liquid, okay, and so they are not able to pass through this liquid. Instead they get trapped in. So as the gas stream passes through the liquid absorbs the gas, and in much the same way sugar is absorbed in a glass of water. So just like when you put a spoon of sugar and you start to stir it, after some time you won't be able to see the sugar. The sugar molecules have broken down, the particles have broken down and they have gotten absorbed into the intermolecular space of the water, right? So in similar way, the gas also gets dissolved in the liquid. So the outlet will have the gas, but it will only have that part of the gas which was not able to dissolve. So you were able to trap some of the gaseous particles. So this process is written over here. So one interesting thing is that the principal type of gas absorption includes spray towers, packed columns, spray chambers, ventute scrubbers. You don't have this much of explanation for these kind of terms. So the point here is that to make the absorption process very efficient, what is done? is that these kind of instruments are used. Okay, this kind of instruments are used for absorption. So what you can do is you can watch this video and you can get some more idea about how this process is conducted. We have adsorption. So first of all, I'll try to explain what is the difference between absorption and adsorption. We have already studied this in chemistry, but anyway, I'll repeat it once. So when a gas or vapor is brought into contact with a solid, now it is not liquid, okay, it is solid. When gas is brought in contact with solid, a part of it is taken up by the solid. The solid itself absorbs a part of the gas. That process is called adsorption. Okay, the molecules are not getting dissolved actually, they will simply remain attached with the solid. So in this way also we can adsorb the particles. When adsorption is done, the particles or the gaseous molecules get attached to the solid, and whatever that comes out of that chamber will be a clean gas. Okay, so this is how it works. Now condensation, if you can convert this gas into liquid, then also you can trap it, right? Because liquid is obviously heavier than and more denser than the gas, so it will become easier for you to trap it. So if you feel like that the gas which you are trying to trap is having a higher temperature, and if you can reduce the temperature, it will condense down to liquid, you can go for this approach. The condensation is the process of converting a gas into liquid. You all know this one. So condensers are typically used as pre-treatment devices. They can be used ahead of absorbers. This will be adsorbers. And incinerators are those devices which is used for burning to reduce the total gas volume to be treated by the more expensive control. So basically, if you look into the three process, four process that I have mentioned here, absorption, adsorption, condensation and combustion, this is the most cheap method. It is the cheapest method. Okay, so first of all, any gas is tried to condensed. So that the amount of gas which is required to be cleaned reduces, because combustion, absorption, and adsorption are costlier approaches. Okay, so this part is done, and then usually we go for other approaches. So actually, this should have been told you before absorption and adsorption. So I'll better rather put it here. Condensation I will cancel and I will put it here. That will be better. I will also do the same change here. Okay, condensation. Absorption, adsorption, and then finally we'll see to combustion. Yes. Okay. So what is combustion? Let's look at it. Combustion, as you know, combustion is basically burning. So how can we burn something to convert it into a non-pollutant gas? So what are the things that are written? Combustion, also known as incineration, is mostly used to control the emission of organic compounds. Mostly used to control the emission of organic compounds from process industries. So if it is organic compound and if you are trying to eliminate it, then you can go for incineration, or in other words, you can burn it. So this control technique refers to the rapid oxidation of a substance through the combination of oxygen with the combustible materials. So if you remember, burning basically means reacting with oxygen. How many of you remember this point? Can you please raise your hand? Okay. So the thing is, when you burn something, it basically gets react. It basically starts to react with oxygen. So combustion is done so that the organic substance can get can react with oxygen, and finally what you get is a compound which is less polluting. Okay, it is not a preferable method in air control, air pollution control. So the point here is, sometimes when you try to get rid of one pollutant, we create another pollutant. So that is why this is the last resort. You will still find, I'm telling you, in solid waste management plants, you will still find combustion is a very popular approach which goes on all around the world. Okay, you have tons and tons of organic and inorganic compounds. You bring them all together into the incineration plant, you put them all inside the plant, and you simply burn. So what happens is that all these pollutants, you are just converting it into gaseous pollutants. So this is just a way of imagining that you have got rid of the pollutant. You have actually not gotten rid of it. You have just converted the solute pollutant into gaseous pollutant, nothing else. So that is why it is not usually present. Okay. So what we have done today is we have talked about various kinds of approaches by which we can control the air pollution. So I'll rather write it air pollution control equipment. So it is air pollution control equipment. And what we have done here, we have tried to look into various processes of controlling air pollution. Now that we know that there are two kinds of air pollutants, one is particulate pollutant and the other is gaseous pollutant. So that is why our approaches were different. So for particulate pollutants, there were four approaches. For gaseous pollutant, there were another four approaches. So we talked about all these eight approaches, and we have seen how air pollution is controlled. Okay. So this is all about air pollution. Okay. So when we started with this unit two, first of all, we talked about the basics of environmental pollution. We talked about the basics of environmental pollution, and then we directly started with air pollution. So here we come to an end to air pollution. There is a small part of water pollution which is there in your course. Okay, your exam starts from when? Is it 6th?
Yes, sir.
Okay, so you will have this PPT, which is called Unit 2 Environmental Pollution. You will have this PPT. Then next you have the first type of environmental pollution, which is air pollution. So this whole PPT you will be having, that I have completed now, and a small part of water pollution. So for water pollution, you will learn up to slide number 25. Okay, so I will start with this. The first part is pretty simple. The main topic that we have to learn here is eutrophication. We will come to that slowly. So the gist is, we have finished with the introduction of environmental pollution, and then we have talked about air pollution. Now we are going to start with water pollution. Okay, water pollution. So anyone, do you wish to ask me anything at this point? Okay, water pollution. Just as air pollution, you can have this similar definition. It is the presence of any foreign substances, it could be organic, inorganic, radiological or biological, in water, which tends to degrade the quality of water so as to constitute a hazard or impair the usefulness of water. So this is a very technical definition. The basic meaning is, water can be called as polluted if it has some substances which are not desirable, and it degrades the quality of water. It becomes unusable. Okay. So there are various sources of water pollution. Various kinds of water bodies gets polluted. Streams, small streams, natural streams, lakes, sea pollution or ocean pollution, and underground water can also be polluted. By substances which are harmful for living things. We know that water is itself is an ecosystem where the various kinds of living organisms are present. So if the water is polluted, you can very well understand that it becomes unlivable for such organisms. Industrialization and population explosion, again, just as in water pollution, air pollution, these are the two primary reasons for water pollution. Okay. So, what are various kinds of water pollution? Water pollutants. Sewage pollutants. Sewage means all that we get in the drains. These are called sewage. Industrial pollutants, which comes out of industry. Agricultural pollutants. So, don't be surprised by the term called agricultural pollutants, because you might be wondering what can come out of an agricultural land which can be called as a pollutant. So, organic farming will not produce any kind of agricultural pollutant. The problem is when we use fertilizers and pesticides. Those are chemicals which are undesirable for the soil and for the water bodies around the agricultural farm. Okay, so those are called agricultural pollutants. Apart from that, there are physical pollutants like radioactive, thermal, and sediments present in water, and petroleum products. Petroleum products, how can it be a water pollutant? Can anyone tell me? How can petroleum product be a water pollutant?
Sir, because they are non-degradable, so
Yes.
they
Tell me.
so because they are non-degradable, that's why these are pollutant for
Your
the
आवाज ठीक है।
water.
I was not able to hear you properly. So क्या होता है, ओशन पे जब ऑयल स्पिल होता है, कभी कभी ऑयल टैंकर्स जो ऑयल ट्रांसपोर्ट करते हैं एक कॉन्टिनेंट से दूसरे कॉन्टिनेंट पे, हाँ वो रीजन तो वो है, दे आर नॉट बायोडिग्रेडेबल, दैट इज वन पॉइंट, बट हाउ दिस पेट्रोलियम प्रोडक्ट बिकम पोल्यूटेड, दैट इज बिकॉज ऑफ ऑयल स्पिल। ऐसे तो पेट्रोलियम तो पानी पे होता नहीं है, लेकिन जब कोई भी टैंकर बर्स्ट करता है या फिर कोई एक्सीडेंट होता है तो सारे पेट्रोलियम क्या होता है ना, पानी में गिर जाता है, दैट बिकम्स ए पोल्यूटेड। ओके, बर्ड्स एंड फिशेस व्हेन दे कम इन कांटेक्ट विद दिस पेट्रोलियम्स देन दे आर नॉट एबल टू सर्वाइव। ओके, सो हाउ डू वी मेजर वाटर क्वालिटी, हाउ कैन यू से दैट दिस वाटर इज पोल्यूटेड? सो देयर आर वेरियस वेज। फिजिकल पैरामीटर्स आर कलर, ऑर्डर, टर्बिडिटी, टेस्ट एटसेट्रा। केमिकल इज पीएच, अमाउंट ऑफ कार्बोनेट, सल्फेट एटसेट्रा, दीज आर द थिंग्स। ओके, सो दीज थिंग्स आर रिक्वायर्ड टू बी मेजर्ड एंड देन वी कैन फाइंड आउट द अमाउंट ऑफ पोल्यूशन। ओके, सो दीज केमिकल्स फॉर्म द टोटल डिजर्व सॉलिड प्रेजेंट इन वाटर। सो द थिंग इज टीडीएस, टोटल डिजर्व सॉलिड, दिस इज ए टर्म एक्चुअली which is measured by environmental engineers, and this has a limit. Okay, for drinking it has a limit, for cleaning purpose it also has a limit. So various kinds of limits are there. If it is found that the measured total dissolved solid of the water that you receive at your home is more than that limit, then you will call it polluted. You may not feel like it is polluted. You won't be able to see anything with your wide open eyes, but if the limits have been crossed, then you will call it a polluted water. There are various kinds of biological parameters also. We sometimes say that there are various kinds of contagious diseases that are around us and it is spreading from water, and that is because of the presence of such biological parameters. Okay? So, usually, dysentery and all these kind of diseases occur due to the presence of biological parameters. So that is why we go for boiling water, right? Now, water is present at various levels, right? Water is present above the surface of Earth. Water is also present below the surface of Earth. So first of all, we will talk about surface water pollution. All those pollutions that happen at the surface of the Earth. Okay? So, surface water pollution. So, you have already known about what is this point sources, aerial sources. We talked about that the last to last classes. So, what happened to this? Okay, point and non-point sources. This is one way of classifying. Another way is natural and anthropogenic sources. So when we pollute the water, then the source is us, man-made source. When it is naturally polluted, it's natural source. Point source means you know exactly from where this pollution is occurring. A non-point source means the whole area is the reason for pollution. Okay, so this picture will help you understand. So this is an industry, so it is a point source. This is another factory, it is a point source. Okay, this is a waste treatment plant. So non-point source, this whole urban area is a source of pollution. This whole urban suburban area is a source of pollution. So it is not a single point. The whole area is polluted. So we call it non-point source. A crop is a non-point source because it covers a large amount. Okay, point and non-point source. So point sources examples could be industrial pollution, where a lot many harmful substances are released into water. So the so why do we call a point source, or what is the significance of calling it? Because it is easy to identify, monitor, and regulate. We can easily point out which is the location and then regulate them. Okay, point sources are very easy to regulate. We can control it. We can limit the amount of pollution. And non-point sources covers a large area, so it can't be tracked into a single point or source. You have to change, or you have to develop the whole area to get rid of such kind of water pollution. Pollution by water from farmlands that mixes in streams. It is quite difficult to control the non-point sources, right? So the whole farmland is the reason for pollution. How are you going to control? It becomes difficult. Okay. Examples, more examples of non-point source: soil erosion, chemical runoff, animal waste pollution. So it covers a large amount of it. Fertilizers from agriculture land, when it leaches out into the water, you apply the fertilizer, you harvest the crops, and then the whole area when it receives rain, the fertilizers goes under the ground. And then it slowly leaches into the, or it percolates into the nearby river streams. Okay, so this is non-point source. Nutrient runoff in stormwater, same thing only. Waste of parking lot, waste of parking lots, roads, highways called urban runoff. So when the urban area receives rainfall, and when it collects all those garbages, leaves, dirt, etc., and it falls into a stream of water, then the whole water body gets polluted. But you cannot control it by pointing out one single source of pollution. So this is called a non-point source. Okay, non-point source. Okay, some more examples of non-point sources. You can look into these figures later. Okay. Natural and anthropogenic sources. Whatever you have talked about up till now, these are all anthropogenic sources. These things. These are all anthropogenic sources. Natural sources, deforestation makes soil loose and flood water will have silt. Okay? When the river, you people are may not be that much aware about the silting. I am from Northeast, so in Northeastern states, whenever there is flood, the river water becomes so polluted with the silt that sometimes you will see that when the water has receded, the water has come down, the whole area, the landscape of the whole area changes, because you will see so much of soil that has come and it was not there last year. Okay, so the whole landscape changes. The area becomes higher. The level, the soil level rises, and it is very fertile actually. But the problem is many a times this happens because of erosion. And erosion will silt the river water. The water becomes very difficult to consume. You have to clean it more for consumption. these are the issues. Siltation of soil is basically due to deforestation. The more you cut down forests, the more soil becomes loose, the more water becomes polluted using because of this silt. So now that we have seen all kinds of sources of water pollution, what are the leading causes? Agricultural activity is one of the biggest cause because of those fertilizers and pesticides and all the bacteria from livestock and food processing wastes, all those agricultural reasons. Industrial facilities, if you belong to an industrial city, you know better. The people from Bhopal and Agra and such cities know how much of industrial pollution reaches the rivers. Okay, these are usually inorganic and organic, they are both. In mining cities also these kind of things happen. If mining is a very common occurrence in a certain city, then you will see that surface mining disturbs the land, and because of that soil becomes loose, because mining is basically digging underground, right? When you are digging, the soil becomes loose, and when it rains, the loose soil reaches into the water bodies. Okay, so this is because of mining. Anthropogenic sources of water pollution, another figure for you to understand. So this is a house, there is a septic tank, okay, this is a sewer, this is a pumping well. So this septic tank is built underground, okay, and it contains all dirty water of your home. So that underground structure is not bound by concrete from all sides. It is open below. So what happens that these dirty water slowly gets percolated into the soil, and maybe you are having a pumping well nearby. So when this dirty water reaches to this water level, your well water is going to get polluted. Even if it doesn't come this deep, it can get percolated and it will leach into the river. So when you take the water out of the river or stream, that water gets polluted. Pollution of stream, another thing. So same thing only, if you leave the dirty water to come into the streams directly, then it gets polluted. Okay. So look into the figure. I will try to explain this curve that they have drawn here, just for your understanding. It's not that important because it involves a lot of chemistry and all. So I'll just roughly explain it to you. Look into the figure for some time, and then I will explain it to you. So see, tell me, if water does not have oxygen, will the fish survive? Tell me, yes or no?
No.
No. Now, when this pollutant reaches the water, this pollutant also require oxygen. Okay, they require oxygen to convert into some other particles. We will not go into that. So fish also requires oxygen. These pollutants also require oxygen. Now, if the amount of pollutant is less, then fish can also consume the oxygen, pollutants can also consume the oxygen, and slowly whatever oxygen that will get depleted because of this pollutant will be recovered, because the whole water body is in contact with air, right? It is not airtight. So it will also try to absorb some oxygen. So whatever oxygen is consumed by the pollutant will get recuperated or replenished by the presence of atmospheric oxygen. But the problem is when the pollutant level is very high, what happens is that the amount of oxygen that is consumed by the pollutant cannot be recovered by absorption of oxygen. Okay, and the fishes find it very difficult to survive. So now you try to look into this figure. This is the clean zone, okay? Water is flowing in this direction. This is the clean zone. And look into this red line, biological oxygen demand. This demand is basically how much oxygen is required by the pollutant, okay? How much oxygen is required by the pollutant. In this part, no pollutant, no demand for usage of oxygen. Suddenly, when you have dropped it here, the oxygen demand has increased. But when the pollutant travels in this direction, it spreads. Okay, it spreads, and so the demand reduces. And slowly, a time comes, which is again a clean zone. So here, you do not have any further demand. Okay, now let's look into how much oxygen is present. In the clean zone, a lot of oxygen is present. As soon as it reaches the pollutant zone, oxygen reduces. Oxygen reduces, and this is the most dirty part. Okay, most dirty part. And then finally, what happens? When the demand for oxygen is reduced, again oxygen level increases and it comes to a normal status, just like it was before. 8 ppm, 8 ppm. The problem is, this becomes impossible. This depletion of the required oxygen and this oxygen cycle, this becomes impossible when the pollutant is very high. Okay, first thing. Second thing, in this dirtiest region, you will not find any fish. Fish is absent. Okay, only a few kinds of fish will be able to survive. Other fish will not be able to survive. You will find all kinds of fish over here, over here. So this is just a diagram for you to understand how this river has its automatic capacity to purify its water. But if you keep polluting it more than its ability to purify, then you are going to destroy all life present in the water. So water treatment plant is necessary. Water should, the pollutant should come out of the water treatment plant and then reach the river. Then only you can save the river. So these kind of issues are usually faced in every city. Here in Ahmedabad also it's present. River Ganga and Yamuna are the most polluted rivers if you look into all the rivers of the world. Okay. So freshwater lake pollution, if it is a lake, because of all kinds of human activities, the lake gets polluted. All the toxins settle into the bottom. If the toxins settle into the bottom, the fishes cannot survive at the lower levels. Atmospheric deposition is also present. Sometimes if the air is polluted, then also it pollutes water. Food chain disruption. You know what is a food chain? Various kinds of living organisms are present and they are not able to survive because of this water pollution. Okay. Now let's talk about eutrophication. So what is this whole thing about? It is the process by which a body of water acquires a high concentration of nutrients, especially phosphates and nitrates. Okay. So the terms might seem to be difficult for you. I'll just tell you one single thing and you will understand what this whole eutrophication is. I hope you have seen some water body which has turned green. Okay, some kind of algae has formed on the top layer. Have you seen this? Anyone, can you tell me?
Yes, sir.
Yeah.
So if you look into any water body, it happens in still water body. It never happens on a moving in a river. So if it is a still water body, you will see that the water has turned green. Actually water, not water, the algae has formed on the top of the water, okay, or on the surface of the water. So that process is called eutrophication. So if it is green, then it is definitely a kind of plant organism. If it is plant, it will need those nutrients which is needed by any other, which is called phosphate and nitrate. You know those fertilizers that we utilize on the agricultural land, that those are also phosphates and nitrates. So usually what happens, if you use fertilizers on the agricultural land, all the fertilizers may not get utilized for growing the crop. Whatever that is left, it comes into the water. Now, we need fertilizer for the land, not for the water. So when it reaches into the water, these algae which are present in very tiny amount, they start to grow because they get all these nutrients. And then what happens? This algae will turn the surface of the water green. Okay. So what happens because of that? Sun ray cannot reach into the bottom. So when sun ray cannot be reach into the bottom, the fish start to suffocate. Why is it so? Because the presence of oxygen is because there is presence of sunlight also. Okay, this sunlight actually helps in maintaining the balance of dissolved oxygen in the water. So when the sunlight gets blocked, all the oxygen starts getting utilized, and then the fishes start to suffocate. Okay. Another way for you to understand this, if you try to look into the algae, okay, so this part, as the algae die, okay, if it is a plant, it will eventually die after some time. As the algae die and decompose, high level of organic matter and decomposing organisms deplete the water of available oxygen. So when this algae dies, it settles at the bottom, and this requires oxygen. If it were plant, you know, plant gives you oxygen, but when it is dead, it starts consuming oxygen. Now the problem is the fishes are not the only consumer of oxygen. Now this algae also starts consuming oxygen, and when algae starts consuming oxygen, the present the past scenario can again comes into whatever you've seen here. There are other entities which needs oxygen other than the fishes. So your eutrophication starts. Okay, this whole process is called eutrophication. Another example, another figure here. Fertilizer runoff, these parts can become green. Algae grow fast, using up lot of oxygen and blocking sunlight. Aquatic plants begin to die. Okay, if there is any plant at the bottom, that will start dying. The dead matter provides food for microbes, increasing their competition for oxygen. So not only fishes require oxygen, now these microbes also require oxygen because they have to consume this organic matter at the bottom. Water becomes deoxygenated, oxygen is gone, fishes start dying. Okay. So what is the step in this process of eutrophication? Whatever I have told you here, I'll just explain in a few points. So addition of nutrients, first of all, fertilizers come, algae grow, then they die. Then bacteria starts to consume this algae. When they starts consuming the algae, oxygen starts depleting. Finally, the fish is not able to get enough oxygen and they start dying. Then the whole water body is eventually dying. Okay. So what are the effects of eutrophication? You can obviously understand from this only. Basically, it's death of all organic matter or all living matter in the water. Increased biomass like phytoplankton in water. This is a kind of a biomass. Actually, it is consumed by sea animals like your whales and all. But in lakes, it is going to be a pollutant only. Decrease in harvestable fish. You won't get less. You won't get enough fish from this kind of water. They are not able to survive. Water quality will get poorer. Turbidity will increase. You will not get clean water. Aesthetic value of water body will go. Water will look very polluted. Oxygen consumption will increase, so biological oxygen demand will increase. And finally, high BOD indicates the occurrence of eutrophication. This is just an indication that your oxygen level has depleted. So I will tell one statement here. So do you want to check whether this water has eutrophication or not? What you will do, you will take a sample of water from here, you go to the lab, and there is a process by which you can calculate this. So if this value comes out to be more than the limit, then you will say that BOD has gone beyond the limit, and so the water is eutrophicated. Okay. So now what can you do to prevent this eutrophication? This will be your last slide for today. And this will also be the last slide for your test that is coming, which is your session and exam. So how can you prevent eutrophication? What can you do about it? So if organic material addition stops, if you can stop somehow the leaching of fertilizers into the water, then you can prevent eutrophication. Okay. Concentration of dissolved oxygen will obviously increase through natural means like atmospheric replenishment, photosynthesis. So if you can cut off the flow of fertilizers, automatically the concentration of oxygen will also start increasing. If there are process of cleaning up water bodies by removing sedimentation or allowing plants and fish to grow again, so various kinds of plants are actually helping water to replenish the oxygen amount. If you can grow them, if you can clean the water by removing all the sediments from the bottom of the lake, that will also help. Organic farming, if you stop using fertilizer at all, then the leaching of the fertilizer will stop, and that will also help you prevent eutrophication. So these are four ways of. First one is to, if you are using fertilizer, try to not allow the fertilizer to go into the water. Second, some kind of farming can help you improve the oxygen. If you are using water itself for various kinds of plant farming, that will also help. If you clean up the body, whatever that has wasted, if you clean it up, that will also help. And if you go for organic farming, that will also help you reduce the eutrophication. Okay, so these are a few points in relation to eutrophication. Okay, then, so that will be all for today. You will see these slides uploaded on your LMS. So you can download it from there and you can go through it for your sessional exam purpose. Okay, any doubts that you may have, we have tomorrow's class, right? So tomorrow in the tutorial class, I urge you to ask your questions. Anything that you might have, I will try to clarify your doubts. So by today, just give it a time of around 15 minutes and go through it so that you are in a position to ask me your questions. Whatever doubts you may have, I will ask, I will clarify. Okay. So that will be all for today. You can.